Hi, thanks for joining us today. If this ministry has impacted your life, we want to hear about it. You can send us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. Also, we would love if you would partner with us financially. You can go to vineyardchurch.com and click the Give Online or text your donation amount to 757-230-2110.
To honor copyright laws, we have removed some audio and video elements from this message. Now here's this week's message.
The Son's dying words to the world, words spoken through pain and great suffering, with passionate love to the ones He was dying to save, are the sum of His life and works, His gift to us, His heart, and the sound bites of God.
Well, welcome to Vineyard Community Church. How's everyone doing? Man, so glad you're here with us today. Pastor Annie and Sharon have given me the opportunity to speak today, so I'm so excited. We've been in a series leading to Easter called Soundbites, where we've been looking at the seven things Jesus said on the cross before His death. Now, when Pastor Andy told me that he wanted me to preach there in this series, I was very excited. I was like, yeah, heck yeah, that sounds so powerful. Jesus speaking to us on the cross, you know that has to be important. And I was very, very excited to speak. And then he sent me the soundbite he wanted me to speak on. So here it goes. Here's Jesus' fifth soundbite on the cross. John 19, 28 in the New King James, it says, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things are now accomplished, that scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. Yep, that's all I got. I couldn't get a sentence or a phrase or something. I thirst. Jesus up on the cross sounded like the Dos Equis man. Stay thirsty, my friends. It's like, how am I supposed to preach about that? You know, I didn't know. But then I did some research on this verse, and then God began to speak to me, and then He actually displayed, He began to display even more of His love to me, what that was displayed on the cross. So check this out. If you are taking notes or following along on your outline or live tweeting to @VineyardVA, you can title part 5 of this series, God Feels Your Pain. God Feels Your Pain. Now, I have a question. Have you ever talked to somebody and you begin to express the things going on in your life, some of the troubles, the hurts, things that are really like specific to your life and how you're struggling with things, and then after you tell them all the stuff that's going on in your life, they look at you and they say, yeah, I feel your pain. I don't know about you. That drives me crazy. I want to say, no, hold on. You don't know my pain. It's my pain. How you know my pain? How can you feel my pain? It's me. You know, recently in my life, I started college again, going back to school. Come on. And I got my biblical degree from our Vineyard Institute program, which is amazing. I encourage you to look into that. But I felt like God wanted me to go back to school and get my bachelor's degree. But now, so I'm doing online college. But for me, education, school, I'd rather someone take a nail and hammer it through my big toe than go back to school. That's where I'm at with school, okay? So it's not very fun for me. I got my GED when I was 19. Like I said, I went to Bible college, and I love God, but that was even like, man, not fun, you know? So I'm in this new season starting online school, now, and I was very nervous, but one of the things that made me not so nervous is because I am married to a beautiful, smart, independent woman who graduated from George Mason University with a 4.0 grade point average. Come on. So I knew if I needed help, oh yeah, I got a wife that can help me. So 2 weeks into this thing, man, already 2 weeks into this, I'm struggling a little bit with some of the classwork, and mainly because of my educational background, I didn't really know how to do school properly, so I was having a hard time. So I got a paper graded, and my professor tagged almost everything I did. Hold on, I got to turn my do not disturb on. Okay. And my professor tagged almost everything I wrote and said it wasn't academic writing. that it sound too preachy. Go figure. It's like, all right. And then after I read that, I was like, how can she tag me on this? No one's ever taught me how to write academically. I don't know. Then I went up to Erin, and I was telling her I was feeling real discouraged. I was feeling dumb, and I was being really dramatic. I get that way sometimes. And then she looked at me after I was expressing my emotions. She says, yeah, Jacob, I feel your pain. I said, you feel my pain? Miss college graduate, Miss 4.0 walking on the stage with the things and throwing your hat in the air. You feel my pain? I said, I could barely understand what I'm reading. I don't know math. I can't read a book. I don't know. And after I was done, you know, being extra and calmed down, she finally got me to stop having a pity party. And she said, I can relate to your pain. And I'm here to help you achieve what you feel like you can't. And then I recognized, first of all, I'm a very lucky guy. You know, she's smart. She's beautiful. She's kind. And she's like my sugar mama. Come on. And so she could relate to my pain. She couldn't necessarily relate to educational struggle, but she's had other things that she struggled in her life and had to overcome. She had other pain, and in that, she can feel my pain, which actually leads me to my tweetable thought today. My tweetable thought today is this: God, through Jesus, can relate to us and understand our human pain. God, through Jesus, can relate to us and understand our human pain. Now, who in here loves an underdog story, right? We all do, right? You know, and now why is that? I think it's because we all can relate to the underdog. We can relate to the struggle. We can relate to the hard work that the underdog puts in. And when the underdog has that victory moment, we all want to share in that experience, right? We all feel like we did it too. Now, that's because we've all had pain. We've all had those moments of feeling like we couldn't do it. Our painful things come in. See, pain comes in many different forms. You may have a physical pain. You may have emotional pain, mental pain, family pain, a pain in your marriage, a financial pain. You may be at work and you may be dealing with someone who's a pain in your, But pain is something you feel and something you don't want. Now, how does God relate to our pain? He's God. He's perfect. He's Jesus. He can walk on water. If Jesus is having a bad day and doesn't feel like going to the store, he can just fill up a bucket of water and turn it into wine and watch Netflix. We can't do that. How can he relate to our pain? Now, the truth is this. Jesus is fully God and fully human. See, he's not 50% God, 50% humankind equals a 100% Jesus. No, it doesn't work that way. Jesus is 100% God, 100% human, equaling out to 100% Jesus. I love math God's way. It's a lot better. Check this out. Philippians 2, starting at verse 6, says this: who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, being found in the appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. He took on human form. God, through Jesus, understands our humanity. He understands us. And we see this with the fifth soundbite that he spoke on the cross when he said, I thirst. He's been beat. He's been left by his friends. He's been trialed as a criminal for not doing anything wrong. And yet the Bible says that he declared, I thirst. Now, my brother, Isaiah, he's a pretty big runner. He loves to run. He's ran multiple half marathons and stuff like that. It's pretty impressive. And he told me, when you run a half marathon, the midway point, they have the station that's filled with energy goos. And I guess these energy goos are like a lifeline so you can, you know, make it the rest of the way. And my brother said he was running, and he was at like a 7-mile pace, which that's like really fast for a half marathon, for a long distance run like that. And he's just getting it. And he's running, and then he sees the goo station coming up, and he sees the people handing out the goo. And he's running towards his goo, and he's about to reach and grab his energy goo. And as soon as he reaches to grab it, someone comes in and takes his goo. And he was like, what the heck? But he said his pace was so good, he didn't want to run back and grab one. So he just kept running. But when he got to around mile 8, mile 9, he started cramping. And he started being really thirsty. And he started thinking, man, only if I got that energy goo, I would have been better. See, thirst is what? A very human need, isn't it? It's a very human thing. To be thirsty and not be able to quench that thirst, it's painful. It hurts. Jesus in this moment is in real human pain. He's in real human pain. Now, we're going to look at the pain Jesus felt leading up to this moment of thirst on the cross. And I believe for us to understand how to get free from our pain, we have to understand the pain that Jesus went through for us. And when we understand that, we can find relief for our own pain in our lives. So I have 3 points about how Jesus understands the tension that comes from life circumstances. Point number one is this. Jesus understands the tension of pain and purpose. Jesus understands the tension of pain and purpose. Now, pain can bring discouragement to your purpose. Pain can make you feel like, God, are you really up to something in this? God, are you really here? Like you promised you would be. In the Bible, we see that Jesus battles with this tension of pain and purpose. Check this out in Matthew 26. It says this. Jesus went with his disciples to the garden and said to them, sit here while I go over there and pray. He took Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. And he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Now, this is only roughly 10 to 12 hours before Jesus' crucifixion, and Jesus is in pain. He was sorrowful. He was troubled. These are real human emotions. These are real human feelings. It's not like Jesus just floated down to earth with his stunning blonde hair and blue eyes, which is a whole other message altogether, and said, here I am, cross. Hang me on it. No, that didn't happen. The reason why, because it is through the gospel story that we understand that our God is relatable to everyday people. The power of the gospel, it is not a story about a far-off God that just had pity on common people, but it's a story about a God who loved his people, that became one of us to understand us and did the things that we could not do and died the death that we deserved so that we can live life and life to the fullest. There's a relatable story here, and we can reach out to him. See, Jesus, in this moment, though, in the garden, he's at war with his flesh. He has a tension here. There's pain and there's his purpose, but his purpose doesn't look that good right now. And I don't know about you, but I battle with my flesh all the time. I got these moments where I know I should be doing this, but I do that instead. I know I should love people like this, but I love them how I think they deserve to be loved. I know I should forgive, but I hold on to a grudge. We're at war with our flesh all the time. And isn't it interesting that our Jesus, our Savior, also had a moment where he was at war with his flesh? See, Jesus says, my soul is overwhelmed. The very essence of him is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Check out the next part. It says, going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken away from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. May this cup, I want you to remember that, this cup. I got a sub point for you too. Be honest with God in your pain. Be honest with God in your pain. He is not afraid of your pain nor intimidated. See, Jesus came to die. That was his purpose. In Jesus, we have a glimpse of what our humanity would be like if we were not tainted by sin. But also in Jesus, we have the atonement of our sin and failures. And through his sacrifice, we can now have relationship with our Creator God. God found his way to us through Jesus. But here in this moment, because of the pain, because of the agony that is to come, Jesus is beginning to question that. Jesus feels discouraged to live out his purpose. Even Jesus had moments that he thought to himself, am I really made for this? Is this what life is all about? Is this why I'm here? God, if you can, just let this cup pass away from me. And have you ever been in a place in your life where you thought, this isn't what I signed up for. This isn't what I thought it was going to be. I didn't think I was going to have pain like this. My spouse did this, and I have this pain, and I can't change what my spouse is doing. My kids are out doing wayward things, and I can't control them, and I got this pain, and I got this issue, and I got these fears. This is not what I thought it was going to be. And we see Jesus with his words, it screams pain. The condition of his body screams pain. But yet he says this one little sentence. Yet not my will, but yours be done. And we see there's pain, but there's purpose. And there's this tension. Even though I don't want to go through this pain, I know there's a purpose on the other side. And actually, the pain that I face now paints a picture more clearly of the purpose God has for my life. And I want you to know today, your pain is not meant to take you out, but your pain will elevate you to the purpose God has for your life. Your pain will bring you where you need to be. Don't give up because you have pain, but keep moving forward because the pain that you face will reveal the ultimate purpose God has for you. Come on, I'm preaching right now. Jesus is to die for the sin of all humankind. That's pain. But then he sees his purpose. Point one is this. Jesus understands the tension of pain and purpose. Point number two, Jesus understands the tension of frustration and faith. Jesus understands the tension of frustration and faith. Where there is pain, there comes frustration. And where there is purpose, we must have faith to see that purpose come to reality. Jesus prays, but yet not my will, but yours. So he's trying to build up that faith. But check out what happens next in Matthew 26. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. That's messed up. He just told them, I'm sorrowful and I'm in pain. He comes back to them, they all sleeping on him. That's messed up. That verse makes me mad for Jesus. Couldn't you men keep watch for me for 1 hour? He asked Peter. Man, imagine Jesus. Imagine being Jesus. He's like, God, I don't really want to do this. Then he starts giving himself a pep talk. Like, all right, God, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this for you. And he's walking back to his boys, to the disciples. He's like, all right, guys, me and God were talking. I know this is about to be painful, but with you guys, man, I know we can make it through. And then he looks up. They all sleeping on me. That's messed up. And I love how he does this. He says, couldn't you guys stay up and keep watching me for an hour? Peter. He's like, he just, like the other ones weren't there. Like, he just blamed Peter. Now, just a fun fact, maybe it's not that fun, but a fun fact, the reason why I think he picked on Peter was because in Peter, he was going to build his church. So I think this verse is here to remind us that sometimes Jesus, the Savior, is dying and the church is just asleep. But anyways, that's another message too. But now he's frustrated. He feels like he's all by himself, and the people who are supposed to have his back are now asleep. And have you ever been dealing with frustrating, painful circumstances, and the people that you thought were going to encourage you, and they're discouraging you? And haven't you ever been so frustrated with personal things going on in your life, you go home, and then you just begin to blame your spouse? Blame your kids. Blame your boss, Peter. We all have a Peter, right, that we kind of pick on sometimes. But in his frustration, Jesus goes back to a place of prayer and talks to God. Even in his frustration, he leans in on his faith. Matthew 26 continues. It says, he went away a second time and prayed, my Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done. When he came back, he found them sleeping again. Dang, twice, because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Subpoint again, go back to God with faith, even in your frustration. Go back to God with faith, even in your frustration. And you see this tension again. He's frustrated, but he knows he needs faith to get through it. Point one today is this: Jesus understands the tension of pain and purpose. Point two, Jesus understands the tension of faith and frustration. And my third point today is this: Jesus understands the tension of struggle and strength. Jesus understands the tension of struggle and strength. Now, I want to go back to Jesus' third time in prayer, because in Luke's telling of the story, something happens here. In Luke 22, it says this: Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. Check this out, this next part. An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. So he prays the same prayer for a third time. Take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. But notice how the Bible says on this occasion, an angel comes and gives him strength. He's praying, he's in pain, and God begins to strengthen him. But check out the next part of this verse. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling on the ground. Now that's intense. There's so much stress, there's so much anxiety for what's to come that he's sweating blood. So he is strengthened by an angel, but his outside appearance is still carrying the burden of what's to come. And Luke puts this in the gospel to demonstrate the intense emotional and physical trauma that Jesus is dealing with. But check this out. I got another sub point for you. Even when things on the outside haven't changed, God gives the strength on the inside to move forward. See, notice that the angel came, and the angel strengthened his soul and it strengthened his spirit. But the things around him, he was still sweating blood because of the anxiety going on. See, even when things around you may not have changed the way you want them to change, with a prayer to God, when you lean into your faith, God will begin to strengthen your spirit. He will begin to strengthen you beyond the circumstances that are outside of you, because honestly, I think God is far more interested in the condition of our hearts than the conditions around us. Jesus is dealing with this, with human pain. And now we see Jesus dealing with this not just as a deity that doesn't understand human pain or hurt, but as a human, which now gives us the ability to not reach to a God who is far off and distant, but now we can reach to a God who understands us, who gets us, who relates to us. He knows how it is to struggle, but then find strength through God. And now Judas comes and betrays him. His disciples leave him. He's tried wrongly. He's beat, a crown of thorns put on his head as mockery. He's made to carry his own cross. He's nailed to the cross. And the Bible says, while he was on that cross, he says, I thirst. I'm thirsty. But why? Out of everything he could say, why? I thirst. Now, I think to understand the thirst, we must understand the cup he was referring to. And I have here the cup of wrath and the cup of salvation. Now, the Bible refers to the cup often. And the cup of wrath, that's the cup we deserve. The cup of salvation, that's the cup we got. That's the cup we got, though. Check this out. Psalm 116 says, I will lift up the cup of salvation, and I will call on the name of the Lord. Isaiah 51:17 says, awake, awake, rise up, Jerusalem. You have drunk from the cup of the hand of the Lord, the cup of his wrath. So we have the cup of wrath and the cup of salvation. Now check out this part right here. They came to the place called the Skull. They offered Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. After tasting it, he refused to drink it. Now this is a poisonous herb. In Mark's telling of the story, it says they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, which would act as a numbing substance for him. It would be so he wouldn't have to feel the full pain on the cross. This cup, Jesus denies. This cup, Jesus didn't take. He had to feel our pain. He had to feel the full burden of our sin, the full burden of God's wrath. And on that cross, Jesus takes it, fully God and fully man. He, on the cross, he tells them, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He looks at the criminal next to him and says, today you'll be with me in paradise. He looks at his mother and with compassion and protection for her. And then as a man, he screams out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And then finally he says, I thirst. Now check out what this verse says in the ESV. It says, after this, Jesus, knowing that it was now finished, said, to fulfill scripture, I thirst. A jar full of sour wine stood there. So he put a sponge full of sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. Now, you may wonder, why sour wine? Is that like the myrrh? Was that another way to try to mock him? See, sour wine was what the Roman soldiers would drink. Sour wine was the drink of common people, of everyday people. The sour wine was not the kind of wine that a king would drink. It was the wine of the people. Jesus, before his death, drinks from the wine of everyday people. It's kind of like he drinks from the cup of wrath, from the cup of what we deserve. King Jesus, in full display of pain and suffering, does not drink from the cup that would eliminate the pain that he does not deserve. Yet he drinks from the cup that we deserve to drink from in exchange so we can drink from the cup of salvation. So we can have what we don't deserve, because it was in his pain that he saw his purpose come to reality. Hebrews 12 says this, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. Hold on. Now I want you to understand this. This verse is not saying the cross was joyful, because the cross was nothing but joyful. It was not a joyous thing. The cross was not joyous. But what was joyous was the salvation of the people that was to come because of the cross. And Jesus said, because of what will come, I will take the pain of the cross, and that will be my joy. See, Jesus says, I thirst because I love these people so much that my pain is worth their salvation. Scorching his shame, sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endures such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. See, this verse in Isaiah said, you have drunk from the cup of the Lord, the cup of his wrath. Who is the prophet Isaiah referring to? Is it us? Do we have to drink from that? No, friends, we don't. Because Jesus did it for us. He did it for us in exchange to give us a cup full of grace. Oh, but there's a problem here. There's a problem that happens. Even though Jesus drank from this cup, often in our lives we find ourselves, because of doubt, insecurity, relational pain, marriage problems, finances, health, all these problems that come. We find ourselves sometimes drinking from this cup because we think this is all we deserve. Oh, I made a mess of this. I made too many problems. This is all I'll be known for, are these issues. But friends, let me tell you something. He gave us this cup. He gave us the cup of salvation. So where we have insecurities and where we have doubts and fears and marriage problems, we have hope, we have light, we have love to get through it. We don't have to stay down because now we have the cup of salvation in our lives. And you thought I was about to drink this, didn't you? Because we have this cup of salvation. It's high quality H2O. Nah. Because the gospel story, it's not about what we do. The gospel story is about what he has done. And what he has done was give us a bucket full of grace. Come out here with this bucket, man. Check this out. Full of grace. See, there's this verse in the Bible. Maybe you know it. Psalm 23 says this. It says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemy." Wait. Hold on. Come on. Can I get this one? You prepare a table before me in the presence of my fears and my doubts and my insecurities and my marriage problems and my financial problems and my worries. You prepare a table before me in front of all the things that are trying to take me out. What does the verse say next after that? It says, "You anoint my head with oil. My cup, come on, overflows." So you're telling me when we got salvation, his grace just overflows our cup. See, it just keeps going and going. Oh, I gotta read this in the, can I read this in the old King James real fast? It says this in the old King James, it said, "My cup runneth over." And I want you to know today, you may be going through something, but let God's love runneth over your cup with his amazing grace. Because no matter what happens in your life, friends, woo, you got the cup of salvation. He even got messed up, but that's okay. You just put it right on it. Oh, you got a towel for me? Thank you. I appreciate that. My pants got wet. Uh-oh. See, I want you to know today, your cup runneth over with his goodness and with his love. The verse continues, it says, "Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever and ever." Friends, you do not have to drink from the cup of wrath. You do not have to drink from the cup of your problems and your worries and your anxieties no more, because Jesus, when he thirsted on that cross, said, "I take all of that," and you can have the cup of salvation and live your life, come on, To overflow, friends. It's that good. Hebrews 4:14 says, "Therefore, since we have such a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess, for we do not have a high priest who's unable to empathize with our weaknesses." Come on. "But we have one who has been tempted in every single way, who knows us, who relates to us, who understands us, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." God, through Jesus, understands our pain. on that moment on the cross with a sponge of sour wine on his lip, displayed his humanity, but also his divinity in completing the task that God gave him, which was to bring us the cup of salvation. Bow your heads with me, let's pray. God, we have pain. We have problems, we have hurts. Do you get us? Do you understand us? I feel like there's some people in here, you're in pain, but you can't see the purpose. You're in pain and you don't understand why. And I feel like the Lord is saying, this may be where you are, but remember who he is. This pain won't last forever. God, we thank you that you can relate to us. And since you can relate to our pain, you can walk with us through it. There's marriages in here that are on the breaking point. God says, I want to walk through you, with this, through you, with you. There's people who are borderline ready to give up on life, and God says, nope. When I was in the garden, I thought about giving up, but I didn't, because I thought about you. And I gave you a cup of salvation. God, I pray for a spirit of joy in the trials, in the troubles. It's like God is saying, take a chance and talk to him. And talk to him. And I feel like God is saying he's fully aware of your situation. You may be in here today and you never made a decision to trust Jesus with your life. Or maybe you have before, but life kind of got in the way and you want to make a decision to trust Jesus again, to commit your life back to him because you want to live in overflow. It's right where you are in your chair. I want you to pray this prayer with me. I'm not going to call you out or embarrass you, nothing like that. But right where you are, if you want to make a decision to trust in Jesus or trust in Jesus again, pray this prayer with me. Just say, Jesus, forgive me for my mistakes. Make me new. Today I trust in you. Today I want to follow you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thanks for listening to this week's message. We hope you enjoyed it. Don't hesitate to write us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. And we'll see you next week.